there is this paper, Squeeze-and-Excitation Networks. It's getting very good results in the challenge, and the idea is very neat. So they submitted their work to ImageNet Challenge, and they're getting very good results. And why is that? This is an overview of the paper in one plot. There is some transformation which takes a tensor and maps it into another tensor. There is the squeeze part, there is the excitation part, and there is the scaling part. So you're doing some transformations after your convolution, or it could be any other operations that you have here. And remember, whenever we are doing these, we are talking about blocks. It's not the entire network, it's just a block that you can take and put it inside your neural network. So it's just a building block of your network. So let's go into a little bit of the details and see what actually is squeeze, what is excitation, and what is the scaling. So for that, we are gonna need some notation. X is our input tensor. It has a height, it has a width, and it has a bunch of channels. U is the output of our transformation. That's the height, that's the width, that's the channel width, and that's our transformation. And as you know, each network, if it's a residual network, that transformation is gonna be different from if you have inception. So don't worry about this transformation, but all you need to know is that you're transforming your input to U. There is this nice way to think about convolutions. So far we have learned a lot of nice ways to think about convolutions. Each paper was thinking differently. You're looking at the same object from different lenses. This is another lens. Let's say V is gonna be the filters of your kernel, and you're gonna have C filters, V1 up until VC. And VC are just the parameters of the Cth filter. So you have a filter that's gonna output the output tensor U. And that's our U, we are breaking it down channel-wise. So what is gonna be the dimension of U1? It's gonna be H times W. So that's gonna be like an image. It has a bunch of pixels. Same thing here. You see the final channel is gonna have a bunch of pixels. So how do you get UC out from a convolution? You take each one of these, for instance, V1, and you convolve it with X. And the convolution operation is just a summation over the channels of 2x2 convolutions. So now this probably you know how to do the convolution. Okay, it's just the inner product of VC times XS, a small window of XS, and then you take that small window and then you slide it over your input. Now VC, you can also break it down into VC1 up until VC prime. And each filter is now gonna have, it's gonna be in RH by W, each one of these terms. So that's another way to think about convolutions. And that's your input, X. Any questions before I go into squeeze? So that was a simple transformation. That was a convolution transformation. So you transform X to U through the convolution, but I included this math here because it's a nice way to think about convolution. It's a different way to think about it. So what is squeeze doing? It's nothing but a global averaging. So it's global average pooling. It's gonna give you Z, which is the squeezed vector, and it's gonna be C dimensional. And for those of you who don't know what is global averaging or global average pooling, that's the exact formulation. You divide by the number of pixels in your image, and then you do a summation over the pixels. And that's gonna give you a vector in RC because each one of these terms are C dimensional. Excitation is just a fully connected network. You take Z, you linearly transform it with a matrix. You do a nonlinearity on top of that. You linearly transform the output of delta, and then you do sigmoid. Sigmoid is gonna give you a number between 0 and 1. So it's sort of like an attention mechanism. Now you're trying to pay attention to channel-wise. To which channel should I pay more attention? And these attention weights are a number from 0 to 1. That's excitation. Usually W1 is going to reduce the dimension. So you go from something C dimensional to something that's C over R dimensional. You reduce a dimension and then you expand it with W2 so that you end up with C, a vector that is C dimensional in the end after this operation. Scaling, you take the input at a particular channel. Basically, you take one of these slices and then you multiply it by the corresponding attention. So that's going to give you SC times UC. SC is a scalar per each of these. That's just a scalar. You're multiplying a scalar by a matrix and there is no confusion there. How to multiply a scale by a matrix, every entry is going to become multiplied by SC. And that's scaling. Any questions so far? And that's going to be X, that's going to give you your X tilde. Now you're ready for the next layer. In the next layer, you probably want to do the same thing or you want to do something different. But this is just a single block of the entire network. The question is, how are we going to incorporate it into different models? What if your underlying model is an inception module? You have X, you do the inception module on top of it, and then you take X tilde out. How do you incorporate squeeze and excitation in an inception? You do your inception stuff, you take the output. So the inception is just your transformation. That's F transformation. The rest of it is a global average pooling, a fully connected ReLU, a fully connected a sigmoid, and then you scale. So the operations that you're seeing here are exactly the operations that you're seeing with the squeeze, excitation, and scaling. That's how you incorporate squeeze and excitation in an inception module. How would you do it with residual connections? That's a usual residual connection. What you do is you do your residual, which is the nonlinear part of the ResNet, and then you do your global fully connected ReLU, fully connected sigmoid, you scale. You add it to your residual, and then you add the input to the output after the scaling. That's how you incorporate squeeze and excitation inside a ResNet. So you, as you can see, you can do it for different models. That's an idea you can apply, that you can apply to different network structures. So that's a hyper idea. So let's see how it performs. And let's go through these papers. We covered ResNet. Now you're seeing it here. And that's now a good idea to wrap our head around how these networks are comparing to each other. ResNet 152 is giving you an error rate or a top one error rate of 23 when you use 224 by 224 images. When you use a higher resolution image, the error is gonna go down. So higher resolution helps. ResNet 200, 200 layers of residual connections, that's the performance. Inception V3, we covered it. Inception V4, we covered it in class. Inception ResNet V2, we covered it last session. So that's how it's how it compares to the previous state of the art. So each one of these simple ideas was improving the state of the art. It was pushing the envelope. ResNext, we covered it, is doing even better. DenseNet, Attention 92, we didn't cover it in class. Very Deep PolyNet, we didn't cover it. PyramidNet, we didn't cover. DPN, we didn't cover. But as you can see, each one of them is improving the state of the art. Now Squeeze and Excitation Network is beating all of them. So that's a very good top five error. And there are some methods that are even beating Squeeze and Excitation Network. NASNet is coming from automatic machine learning. We are gonna cover that. It's neural architecture search, and net is for net. That's how good it's doing. And the squeeze and excitation net after the challenge is this.
What did they change post-challenge that would have improved the accuracy?
So usually the way that things work is that they submit their work. So I'm not sure exactly what they changed, but that doesn't really matter much. Probably they trained it differently. Probably they had different initialization for their weights and biases. Maybe they were using different model ensemble. But what I want you to take away from this paper is this big idea of a squeeze, excitation, and a scale. And you're paying different attention with that scaling operation to different channels. You're paying more attention to a particular channel than another channel. And the network is going to decide that on its own. Does that answer your question? I tried.
Yeah, that's good. Thank you.
So now let's take a bunch of these famous networks like ResNet 50, ResNet, ResNext, VGG, Batch Norm Inception. These are the original top one and top five errors reported in the paper. This is their own re-implementation. This is the number of flops that it takes, floating point operations. After adding ResNet, yes, you get some improvements, which is great. And the cool thing is that these operations, squeeze, excitation, scale, are not adding much more operations. So these networks are going to be as fast as the previous ones, slightly more costly computationally, but more accurate, significantly more accurate. And why is it not costly? Because the only operation that you're doing is just a bunch of summations, a bunch of matrix vector multiplications, and a scalar being multiplied by a matrix. So these are the added flops. And like any other network, this one also is revealing something interesting. For different output, the output could be a goldfish, it could be a pug, it could be a plane, it could be a cliff, etc. You're plotting the activity of these channels. What are you plotting? You're plotting these excited ones, basically the attention. Early on in the layers, you don't see much difference in the activities, but as you go deeper inside the network, these activities are becoming more discriminative. So you're starting to see the difference between a goldfish and a pug in the activities of these networks after the excitation. So now you're visualizing, it's giving you a means of visualizing what's inside, what's happening inside your network. We are gonna cover a lot more visualization, but this is the first time that you're visualizing something inside your convolution. The cool thing about these attention mechanisms is that it's easy to visualize them. And this is the first time that you're seeing attention in this class. I think we are 1 minute over time. For those of you who have questions, you're more than welcome to stay and ask. And for those of you who want to leave, you can leave.
I had a quick question, not from any of today's material, but just from something from the last slide, I think. Mm-hmm. There was a graph in there that was showing the drop in error as learning progresses. And I noticed that we didn't see any of those sort of sudden drop-offs in the error like we had been seeing for other sort of like learning progressions. I don't know if, so yeah, that chart right there, in other charts like that, we had seen this sort of like, it would be a slow descent and then we'd have a sharp drop, and then like a slow descent and then a sharp drop.
Yes, so that's a good question. There are a couple of ways to do your learning rate schedule. The big idea with your learning rate is that you want to start big because you want to learn faster, and then you want to gradually decrease the learning rate. One way to do it is to do it stepwise. Like after 40 epochs, lower the learning rate by a half, and then you're gonna see a sudden jump. And then after 60, epoch 60, do another step. And then that's gonna give you that step behavior. Another way of doing that is to decrease your learning rate smoothly from 20 up until 60, either linearly, either exponentially. So there are various ways of doing it. And that's called learning rate schedule. So they're using a different learning rate schedule.
Okay, and this one's just more continuous sort of instead of?
Yes.
Okay, cool. Thank you.
Sure, any other questions? Okay, great.